the government from a larger perspective, considering things like policy, organizational issues, business processes, workflow processes, see how everything fits together. So with any kind of technological innovation or implementation, we try to look at it from that bigger perspective, working with different agencies. And one of the things we've been doing recently in regards to mobile in the past few months, and Don and I have both been involved in this to various degrees, is talking with agency personnel at all areas of responsibility and job title within New York State agencies, then within New York City, so we had a state and a municipal feedback, and then at the federal level down at D.C., and actually Don was just down in a workshop there this week, just kind of collecting data around those types of issues of what, if in terms of going, what going mobile means to an organization. And rather than just looking, which is a great temptation and a great tendency to just jump into, you know, developing a nice app because it's exciting to do, is maybe, and that's why the title came up, Step Away. It's not anti-smartphone, it's just a step back and take a bit. So that's kind of what I thought we'd do today is kind of maybe with the people in this room brainstorm around these issues. One of the things I'm interested in from your standpoint is if you are involved either with your organization that you've already gone mobile and whatever that means, what you've discovered as you've gone down that route, what kind of things have arisen either that you didn't expect or that you didn't expect, what you had to prepare for, et cetera, how that came about. And then if you haven't gone mobile yet, but you're obviously, I think everybody's thinking about it, what you're thinking about along those lines as you go down that route. What are the challenges? What are the barriers? What are the opportunities? And maybe like to put together, maybe even out of this short session, is some kind of landscape picture of these are the things that are critical to think about. But to get that kicked off, I'd just like to take a quick run around the room with each of you, and if you could just state who you are, what your organization is, and what your objective was in coming to this session, what you expected this session to get out of it. Let's see if we can address it on that. So if I could just start with you.
My name is Brent Rose. I'm with Housing and Community Renewal. I'm a Citrix administrator, and we've already gone mobile in not applications, like creating Android or iPhone applications, but more of bringing our applications remotely, running them on our servers and, you know, remotely using them. And hoping to see if, you know, strategically if we did anything wrong or something that comes out that we could improve on is what I'm hoping to get out of it.
Jeff Kahapka, same organization. I manage the desktop and the health issues. And one of the big initiatives we're working with is, like all three of us are just going to probably reiterate, is the mobile access to anything. And using different types of mobile devices. We've been testing a bunch of different ones with a lot of good success. I guess what I'm looking to see is what's new out there in the cloud computing.
So what's new in the mobile world?
Sure.
Okay.
I'm Nandu Vembar. I'm a developer at New York State Temporary Disability. I'm also a system admin for PFS. We're not doing any mobile apps right now, but there has been talk that if we do, you know, how should we look at our applications right now to be able to adjust to that?
This is actually, I'm working on a stand-up comedy routine, so I just got to be going.
You
got
to
show the camera.
This is my old material. I need new material. I'm sorry. Okay.
I was just curious to see what others were doing as far as mobile apps. Right now, we're not doing anything with them. We are doing, you know, pretty nice web apps, but there has been some talk of what if we did go mobile? Could our apps scale to a smaller screen, smaller resolution, things of that nature? So just curious to see what others are doing.
I'm Eric Steinborn from the Division of Criminal Justice Services. We've
are at sort of a disadvantage where we don't have a CMS or anything set up yet in our site. So we're a Dreamweaver group. So we use Dreamweaver templates, and all of our stuff is static content, with the exception of our sex offender registry, which uses a static content template. So we're at the disadvantage that we can't just roll something out that will automatically change from a desktop device to a mobile device and send different content and optimized images to, you know, mobile devices so that they're not downloading full ones. So what we've actually had to do is we recently used CSS media queries to create sort of a responsive design where we will shrink your content and display a different navigation if you're on a mobile device. So a lot of people will give you sort of a trimmed down version of your site, but what we wanted to do is we wanted to have, since we're a state agency, we wanted to give out all of that content to everybody regardless of what device you were on. So we just moved the navigation around and we used some jQuery to change some effects on the screen. Yeah. So it works for most small devices. It even works on Blackberries to a limited extent. But we're looking at, you know, making more of our stuff. We're looking at possibly getting into a CMS, so maybe delivering different content server side to different devices, and just looking at going that way rather than just saying we want to make an app, and this is how we're going to do it. We want to have our stuff available on the web to everybody.
On a less technical bent, I'm really thinking about, I want to discuss, how could mobile be used? How could we change some of the cultures and the way people even think about? Specifically, an example would be like, we've got a guy on a bridge who's there to change a sign, and he sees a rusted bolt in the thing. How can he do that? What do they call it? The snap repair thing? How do we get the workforce thinking about how they can use their mobile device to better inform how we become more efficient as a state?
I'm Karen Gee. I'm with HP, and I'm here to actually learn from you about the practical applications that you've found for mobility in state government. I can also share some of the things that I've seen across the nation because I represent our applications practice nationally. So,
Samuel Carrera from DOT. I'm here because I'm curious about using mobile technology. In specifics for probably some of our inspectors, either for bridge inspections or for bus inspections, etc. Just curious. I've been in several projects, and in some of those they mentioned this kind of applications. So I want to see what is out there.
We're just going around and ask people to say who they are, what organization they're with, and what their expectation was in coming to this session, what they wanted to get out.
He's a good person.
Wow. Well, I'm Ben. I am with Reinvent Albany. I didn't really have any expectations. I just thought mobile sounded the most interesting.
Tom Bedali from Xerox. We actually have why we thought about this session is because we have an application of mobile printing, something that traveling, anyone, I want to say executives, or anyone that's traveling from office to office that could print without having to go to somebody else in the office and have it printed. You could print anything that's on a email or any kind of smartphone or tablet or whatnot, and just walk up to one of the multifunction devices, put in the code, after you can pull up a document or, you know, any type of document, and print it out on the spot.
Cindy Behe with transportation. I've been heavily involved with when we launched 511 New York, which also now has a mobile component for a lot of the devices. So really interested in, to see where we can take it from there, or let alone with all the other things we have in transportation, to kind of make ourselves transparent and to get stuff out on devices for the public and our internal employees.
Michael Upman, also from transportation. You know, we have an application where we have air cards for the laptops and people out there. We have 9,000 people in our agency, so most of those are people out in the fields or out at remote sites. But none of our applications, other than the 511, are really designed for mobile devices. You know? So for a laptop and air card, it's kind of clunky, and we just really can't seem to get off the ground to develop an application designed for a mobile device.
Ricky Gomez, CIFT. We've been looking at building mobile apps for like iPhones and Androids, but pretty much what we're trying to do is just build web services so that we have stuff available for us if, when we get around to building mobile apps in the future.
This is Sharon Rader with DEC, and we're looking at not so much mobile apps, but just taking our website and making it work better on mobile devices.
I'm Eric Bosner with DEC, and the group I'm with is looking for ways for people in the field to be able to do their work remotely.
Okay, good. I think we got everybody. So it sounds like we have a pretty decent mix of people who have already been involved in deploying mobile and people who are looking to get there. And there's been a mix between external, I call externally facing apps, citizen facing apps, and other things that are used to support the workforce, all those kind, which are kind of in line with the kind of issues we were seeing. I'm just gonna give one more framework question and then kind of open it up again. One of the things we're looking at now when we're talking with agencies and organizations in terms of their strategic framework is where they're mobile, rather than looking down at the bottom, say you have a government-to-citizen app that you want need to develop. I'll use 511 as an example, it's right there. Look back up the pyramid to your organization and start, as you do with any strategic thinking, start with the mission of your organization. How does this fit within, or does it fit within our mission? What are the policies? And then work down to the policies. Do you have the policies in place? Do you need new policies? Are there policies we haven't considered that need to be considered? Looking at your infrastructure in terms of your technical skills, your data infrastructure, your networking infrastructure, are you able to support it? Have you considered that even at this point? Also, your workflow and your business processes. Is this, and I'm just, again, pulling an example from the room, does the mobile 511 app, and I'd be interested to hear, has this affected internal workflow processes that didn't anticipate or did anticipate and were accounted for, or those kinds of things? And then getting down into the actual deployment where you have, and we've kind of categorized them in four different ways. You have your government to citizen app, your government to business apps, I shouldn't even use the word app, government to business perspective, your government internal workforce, which I think more is what you guys were talking about, making your workforce more efficient, and your government to government, just sharing across, and how, you know, so it's really kind of within that big, broad perspective. So,
one of the biggest challenges that we heard, especially within the federal government area, was thinking about it from, number one, the user, whoever the user is, whether it be your citizen or your work staff or whomever. What is the purpose of doing this app? Not to just have an app or a mobile device out there, but what is it really that we're trying to, what problem are we trying to solve by giving them a device that they then can do something with? And then looking, as Jim says, looking back up through the organization, how is this going to be impacted all the way from not only the IT department, but then also at the program area? How are we going to have to retrain people? What are we going to expect from them? How are they going to actually use this in the field? And then how does it fit back up into our mission? Because you're going to have to deploy resources, whether it be financial or staff, in order to do this, and especially in these times. And there are opportunities. Some of the departments were talking about just getting their data in a way, because they were looking at transparency. The mobile device provides you with transparency. How are you going to get your data in a format so that you put it out there and let people build the apps they want to build? You know, they'll come, kind of idea. The other way was looking at it of how, what is it that I'm going to make available, and then what are the security issues that I have to take into consideration, because now I have new security issues that I have to deal with from a mobile app perspective. And again, if you just look at the app, you're not taking in the full picture of it. So I don't know if that helps.
And I was thinking if I could put it in terms of just a diagram of opportunities and barriers. I want to, if you don't mind, I'm going to talk about housing and transportation, because we both mentioned you have things going. And one is internally focused, one, at least from the 511, was externally focused. And you were talking about bringing that capability within to improve your staff. And were there, when you first got into this, I mean, what was your motivation in terms of the opportunities you saw? And then were there any barriers that were you had to overcome or account for as you rolled these things out? And,
I think from the technology side, I know our applications department is looking at calling down, asking those questions, what are they going to do with mobile apps type of thing? You know, what? I mean, a few years ago it was with rent administration application, for an example, it was just a paper form that people filled out and sent it in, you know, to the agency, and then it got all manually entered. You know, and they developed an online web app form for that. You know, that's now the next step is, are they going to make it a mobile application? Does it solve anything? I don't know. But in the meantime, we've had issues just with, it's more with people that are, we have a lot of inspector type people that go out in the field all the time, and they have devices with them for taking pictures and documenting all kinds of things like that. That was one of the initial drives to, you know, how can we make it more productive for them so that they can just do the stuff live? And that's where we're kind of working with all these devices that are through the Citrix back end. It's really worked well. And also to kind of limit the number of devices they have to carry. In this example here, it's just a little smartphone. And, you know, you got your phone and your email on your hip, but if you want to log in and get your full desktop and have all your applications back at the office with you while you're standing right there and a lot somewhere is out inspecting the place, they can do that too, and it's all live. As long as, you know, it's all relying on your communications networks that are out there. But
have you had problems with that?
Not
in terms of communications?
My daughter was sick one day, and they said to take the smartphone home with the docking station and try it out and see if I could use it. I connected the smart term to my Wi-Fi. I noticed a little bit of lag, but nothing that wasn't workable. I don't know if I would want to work on something like this full time all day without a mouse or a bigger screen, but for, like, we have offices in New York City, for going to the city, getting something quickly done on the train, you could certainly use it.
Well, there are other docking stations too you hook into that are full-size desktop. So if you're going to use it back at the office, one of the things too is economically, some people right now will have a laptop, a desktop, maybe multiple offices, and their laptop has a mobile card in it. They also have
BlackBerry
that we're paying an account on. You know, so if you have one device, you're just paying one account. There's a cost savings there with that. Yeah, I mean, some, you know, the networks, is, you might have a lag here or there. That might be a little bit of a drawback for some, but you're really getting a lot.
Like, we have inspectors out there that we're going to be deploying, like, these toughbooks. They have the camera already built into them. So instead of them taking the notes down in paper, taking pictures with the camera, then having to come back into the office, pop it in the memory card, and, you know, there's a productive delay there, because I mean, these inspectors, some of them don't come into the office for you know, like 3 days or weeks, and it slows everything down. With our help and with the toughbooks, they can take the picture, write their notes, fill out the form, and have it by the time they, you know, have it sent out, you know,
back into the data center.
So someone's already made the strategic decision that there's a cost benefits to doing this. And the manpower that it takes in order to create all this is well worth the investment for what the efficiencies are.
Exactly.
So that was at the program office, or was that at a higher level? Where did that, do you have any idea?
It was a combination of myself and our director and assistant director of this overseas, the IT. And it all kind of became about because of when we went down the road of Citrix, we had this strong back end that allowed us to use all these other tools to access what was already there.
Okay. So you had a technical infrastructure in place that already supported this.
Yeah, and that wasn't an issue. That was for another initiative to get away from managing desktops.
Yeah.
You know, which we did at one of our sites. We're just getting off topic, I guess, but that's how that came about. And now, and Citrix just keeps evolving. Not that I'm, we had a lot of trouble with Citrix in the beginning. I was about ready to throw it out at one point, but now it's you know, it's really developed and it's got a lot of things you can leverage.
One of the things that we've also seen, and I don't know if this is the experience of other people, too, mobile, what they talked about down in Washington was mobile's the next shiny thing. So you have this next bauble that everybody then wants to run after, and if you're a little bit older, you remember that websites were the first shiny thing, and everybody had to go get a website up, and we weren't sure what to do with websites. We put content up. Then now we have mobile apps, or apps, web apps, that we now can make available on websites. So how do you take this next shiny thing and make it be something that you can actually use and see the efficiency of? So has there been, I mean...
Let me, may I?
Yeah, jump in.
What... It's almost a which comes first. What would you be trying to solve? What is the result that you would see from this efficiency? Okay, so quick 1 minute example is, you know, I've got an app that I bought for 99 cents, mm-hmm, that feeds a $5 app that sits on my computer at home, and it's a home inventory app. So I go around and I take pictures of my fridge, my computer, my furniture, my wife's jewelry. And for $6, I get this picture of everything that I own that's stored in the cloud, so that if everything burns up, I've got a record and can go to insurance to do that. This is $6. Now, the benefit to me was, I've been talking about a home inventory for years, but until it was easy, I didn't do it.
Yeah.
Right? So the efficiency, the value, the result that I measure is now I've got a home app. Right? Now I've got a home inventory. So one is I had a need that was met, but it also had to be easy, right? And it wasn't just that I had a pre-existing one in a three-ring binder that I needed to replicate, right? And a lot of the stories I've heard here are, well, we've got this work process, how do we bring that to the mobile device? And a lot of times that's paving the cow path. You know, this is it's an age-old problem. How do I record all my stuff? But they came up with a whole new model for doing it that they're hoping will scale, because they're only making $6 per home to do that. So, I don't know.
But I think also having the back end there
made
it easy. It gave you that bridge to get over. And I think that's where the struggle is right now with a lot of organizations.
What about with 511? Because you hit kind of an infrastructure in place there, too.
Well, what we did several years ago was... a large component of 511 was the telephone system. So when people are traveling, you call 511, that's the phone. I think states were kind of mandated to have that a long time ago. New York wasn't in compliance. So at that point, we launched and outsourced our applications, along with them building a whole telephone system and building the whole 511 MY site. So at that point, it became outsourced because it needed to be tightly integrated. You want your phone and web and all that delivery to become one platform. The telephone systems and that... We weren't able to do that, although we did a good job at our application. So that really was the launching point. And I think, you know, when you talk about data transparency, we've always been there. Even when we had all of our traffic and travel maps inside, people get RSS feeds, and there was stuff that would go out to the media to where, you're right, the sky's the limit on make this open, let them use and do it. The public needs to do. Let them go build the apps. And we had some of those conversations. Why, you know, people should be out there building the mashups and consuming our data. It is somewhat available now. When we first launched, it wasn't, because you know, you got a system and they open it up and everybody else is building the apps. But, you know, so some of those decisions, I think, changed back then on how we do that. But I still, you know... Where it became very important with 511 is people are mobile. I mean, they're traveling. The phone system, I think, would soon become outdated, although that was built. But people need to be able to get things where they are when they want to now, and where are they traveling, and they have mobile devices. So, you know, for us, I think it was critical on there from, like, data perspectives. I think, you know, people can get a lot of that data scraped off of the site right now with RSS feeds to where they can start to maybe build their own stuff. And I think that needs to still probably be even more open, because the things they can take from there and build, I think the sky's the limit with all these little techies, you know. And what else?
And have you experienced any changes or impacts of on your internal workflow processes based on the fact that 511 going mobile compared to when it was just 511, or were you completely at capacity to handle that and it had no impact?
Well, recall, it is outsourced, so from what I understand...
Well, that's what, actually, not to interrupt you, but you know, I did just interrupt you. That's one of the ways to handle capacity is to outsource it. Go ahead.
Yeah, and we did that before. So the mobile apps came afterwards to say we really need to do those. So they use, I believe, most of all the same infrastructure and data and to really get it to that app and the delivery. So I don't, you know, I don't think it's been like a whole big change in the process. You're really using
Yeah, for the last 10 years, we've always been collecting that information and sending it out to the website, the non-mobile website and stuff. So I don't think that really affects us. We just now have a web service that we could render that information out to the vendor, and then they post it on the mobile device, like that. So it really hasn't affected our data collection.
Yeah, because we have all the traffic management centers around the state, so they're still doing their job of recording the stuff. They might have different systems now that they have to use, you know, of how they get their stuff in, and that's the hub of a lot of the data of what's happening. Then that goes all down to our data center down in Virginia, or New Jersey now. And then that's where all the maps and our servers are to disperse everything and to build all the layers on the maps and the telephone system, which is integrated to the web and the alerts.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things we've been hearing, actually, what you both said in terms of how do you direct your mobile energies for an organization. One of the benchmarks for that is if you have a application and a capacity that's already in place, and now either to increase efficiencies or because that's where the people are, you can easily migrate it, and it sounds like it was a relatively easy migration for both of you. The reason I interrupted you for a minute there, Cindy, and asked you a question, is that's not always the case from what we've been hearing. And like a 311 is one of the more classic examples, with, you know, where people call up and say, I have a pothole. You know, that's a long-standing thing, and it looks like you know something about that, so I'll turn it over. But, you know, there was an infrastructure in place to handle that. You know, you get a call, there'd be some workflow process. I'd fill out the paper. When various cities went to that, and suddenly it was done through a smartphone, just walking by, taking a picture, and all of a sudden, the volume, the quantity affected the quality of the service. And that's something that some places weren't prepared for, and then they had to adapt to that and ramp up very quickly for it. So there are, I mean, in terms of, again, strategic thinking, these are things that are helpful if you're just getting into it to think about, if you have that chance to think about it and account for it beforehand.
I'd be interested to hear, I want to hear about the, I don't want you to jump, I want you to jump in for the 311, but for the people who are thinking about it now, that you don't have an application, you don't have, you're here to learn because you wanted to know a little bit more about smartphones and mobile apps. What's the barrier to getting started in your agencies? What is it that's preventing you? Is it because you don't have top leadership support or the infrastructure or the resources? What is it?
Funding at the local counties is one of the issues.
Okay.
I mean, there's a lot of things we want to do, but ultimately it's their call as far as what kind of equipment they have for their staff. Okay. I mean, we're having trouble with them even getting newer computers. So I don't know how much they'd be in support of doing mobile devices and whatnot, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes people don't realize what they're getting into when they start building mobile or looking to build a mobile application. They think that they can do that and just expose what they have built in COBOL 30 years ago. And they don't understand that there is a code transformation effort that has to be in place to make that mobile applicable. And when they realize that, the cost of it goes up and maybe the benefit isn't what they were expecting to see. The other thing that we see fairly frequently is that people try to make things mobile that are very complicated. A mobile application works best if it's really simple. You know, something like reporting potholes. We've done that for Anaheim. or showing people maps of the bike paths or things like that that can be very well contained in a single service is what makes a good mobile application. So
I think that point that you just made about what keeping it simple, one of the things down in DC that they talked about is instead of create, a lot of times we'll create applications that are from our perspective that we think are important, but really how do you expect your user to actually interface with this? And having a map of bike paths is something that a user would want to use, not having the whole infrastructure of the city mapped out.
If it's too hard to use and the user interface is too complex, people won't use it and they'll actually get frustrated and annoyed. Mm-hmm.
And then the cost to get them back to try it a second time is
yeah, you've lost the benefit that you were trying to get out of it. And it is harder to get people to go for it the second time.
Maybe that's part of our problem. We keep it simple, I think, maybe is what we need to do. Because, you know, we're talking about, okay, we need to have GIS component capabilities with it. We need to have, it has to be rugged, so we're researching all these rugged tablets and stuff. And we're just like overwhelmed with, well, which tablet? Okay, well, we researched it 6 months ago, and now it's a different model. We should recommend it. So we just, it's just too overwhelming, I think, for us. What are good standards? What are some good?
I think that I don't have the data, but I think the UPS did something like that, where they first started with this multi-$1,000 device. And eventually went back to a really almost semi-disposable. We know that we have a break X number of these per month, right? So they went to the lower cost. I mean, you can buy an iPhone 3GS for $49 now with a contract, I think. So, you know, if you bought in volume, what if you gave them the older, you know, last model's device and treat them as, you know, we're going to need to replace these every month or every 6 weeks?
I'm guessing from what you're saying, you're looking at internal agency users. You're not talking about constituents out there.
Right, mostly the inspectors so we or the construction workers.
And when we talk about inspectors, then you have to think that they are getting older as we are and that they cannot read small fonts and write in small, and they hate that, you know.
Yep.
So, so then you need to get to bigger devices so they can interact with them.
So I'm kind of curious, you had good luck with Citrix, but you're on a small screen other than your guy there. But say you didn't
want to, you wouldn't want to run the desktop on the phone. And
you can, but it's painful.
You can't.
That's what I. Yeah.
And I wanted like you're saying, how do you get it to work on a tablet? And I don't mean to be an advertisement for Citrix per se, but really, this is not running on this device. This is running on a VMware server back in my office. This is just an image of my desktop that's running.
And you're talking about like rugged tablets and things like that. If you did have a 4S device, there's always skins that you can put on it that make it rugged, that make it waterproof, that, you know, you can drop the thing and it's not going to break. So there's always, you know, you don't have to buy the, you know, the $1,500 tablet, which has the shock factor and all that, when you could get something that would cover a $500, you know, tablet of some sorts, and, you know, that are shock resistant, that are shatterproof and things like that.
Actually, you guys brought up a really good point about it running. It's running on a server someplace. You have a choice in mobility to run it off a server and have it web-based, or you can do a standalone application that's downloaded. You can do much more complicated things if you're running off the server, but I will tell you, as a user, as a smartphone user, I want to use the app on my phone because it's a lot easier to navigate and deal with. I don't want to do complex tasks that way, but, I mean, just for example, I fly all over the country, and I use everybody's app to check in for my flight. And I hate the ones that are web-based because invariably the print is tinier. It's not really mobile. You know, it's great on a tablet, but on my mobile phone, it just stinks. So
Well, like I'm running a desktop here. We also have the ability to deliver just single applications. So, like if someone emailed you like a Word document that you had to read right away, you could do it on your phone. It would be small, but like I said, I wouldn't want to use that for everyday use.
For example, like when we got hit with the Hurricane Irene came, the weekend before, we were given an application to put onto our Citrix server so that other people could use it.
Mm-hmm.
We put that on in 5 minutes, loaded it up, and they were able to use it. And what it was just a simple application that they would enter the data and it would go into, you know, the form for people who needed housing and things like that. We delivered that instantly.
Yeah.
To whoever needed it.
Yeah.
And so all the recovery centers out there needed it. Now let's say if that hurricane somehow flooded Hampton Plaza where our Citrix servers are. We have a SEMO server up at, and we have a Citrix server up at SEMO that we fall back to.
Sure.
And we have a backup of that too.
Sure, a perfectly good hot site.
Correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So any of our, you know, they go down, we, you know, we can do it.
So let me ask this, what's the, it sounds like we're starting to describe, you know, apologies my friend DOT, a roadmap. You know, you've got to have this infrastructure, you've got to make the app simple, you've got to give the user the ability to either contribute to or collect information, but not really process it, because that's too complex. But I think one of the questions Donna asked before was, how do you tell that story to the leadership? How do you get the funding that says, you know, we're not looking to replace desktops here, we're trying to get the infrastructure in place so that a $300 phone, you know, or a $50 phone in the future, because you think about the ramp on those prices, can be used to do this sort of thing. You know, what would it look like in a classroom or in a garage setting where we're performing maintenance and all these trucks? I guess my question is, could this group kind of come up with a step one, step two, step three?
We're going to kind of go through that right now. We're going to invite our executives to see what we have to offer and let them try it out.
I think that's where you have to have someone who's succeeded, who's shown productivity, cost savings, and then use them as a, you know, look what they've done.
Right.
You know, they can, you know, they can do it. Yes, we did have everything on the back, you know, already set in place. But you need someone to succeed and to show it as a kind of like a plateau where, you know, they've saved this much. Yes, there was the startup cost, but now it's...
Well, we also have people from the executive level coming and asking us for it. You know, they see all these devices out. I mean, they're advertised everywhere, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're like, we want to use it to do our work, you know? So there's that driving
but there's
force,
the,
too.
There's the cost saving on personal devices, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I have an iPad, too. I don't want I don't want anybody to buy it for me. I have it at home. I would like to use it on our email server. I would like to use our Citrix. Right there, contact. You don't have to pay for the device, and you don't have to pay for the data plan, really.
No, but you run the security risk of having a device that you're not.
We do have to pay.
That's
for
right. As the agency, we pay for EMM, which secures that device.
What so if you lose the device, though?
We can remotely wipe it.
EMM is a product by McAfee. You install it on the device that's installed on here, where I could call up. I said, I lost my Motorola Atrix. You know, I have my email on it. They could, it's an EMM server. I haven't played with it yet, but they can remotely wipe this device and any information on it.
So you have a bring your own device policy in your agency.
It's all in pilot.
It's in pilot.
Pilot,
but you are already starting to talk, because I know OMH is also talking about a bring your own device. Are other agencies looking at that as well?
Yeah.
DOT?
I believe, letting people use their own smartphones and then being able to get mail and things like that that we did not allow. I believe it's kind of in pilot. I think they're probably all seeing the cost savings and why not take advantage of it, because we all have to carry around multiple devices all day long. And just some other challenges on some of the, it's very, as we go forward, you know, the technology's changing every other day. How do we as state agencies keep up with being able to develop apps, especially for the public, because they're on 101 different devices and we're back to all of us in the old web world, like there's browsers every, how do we keep up? And I think it's going to be more challenging with the mobile devices, because they're, you know, unless they really standardize a lot, when they developed the 511 site, I was hearing, well, we want it to look like the website, you know, people should have that look and feel, and guess what? They all went out and developed what the website looks like, and it's kind of like...
It's tiny, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like, no, you missed the boat. Like, that's not what it's about. And we, you fight those challenges to where, are you going to get what you need that's going to be easy to use? And I don't use the 511 mobile stuff on my BlackBerry, which is our department device, because it doesn't work right. And they're like, well, yeah, we have problems with the BlackBerries. And it's like, well, yeah, but that's our department device, and I'm a big user, you know, I'm a BlackBerry user. Well, it's good for things that run on apps. Well, you know, so those are the challenges we're going to really face, and how do we as agencies keep up with, you know, ours is outsourced and a company did it, but we're going to be paying for that forever, because it's always going to need to be upgraded, it's always going to need more devices, and it's always going to be, you know, the endless pit of money, and how do we get agencies up to speed to where we can support mobile efficiently?
Right. The cheapest and basic for like a website or something is to go WAP and just have it as simple as possible, where you're still using the website, but it's just first name, last name issue or something, you know, like where it's just shown on that one screen, you can read it.
I think that's interesting, that and what you said earlier, where we're kind of intimidated by, you know, we have all these COTS applications, and the vendors say, yeah, we can mobilize it, but, you know, it's going to cost you $1 zillion and this and that. And that's, you know, for us to get training through that. But I think you guys using current technology that you have, keep it simple, and just put it out on an application that would be on your desktop that you already know how to do, and then expose it through Citrix like that. So that's a concept I hadn't really thought of before.
Well, we kind of missed the public. You know, this would be internal. Or like public, I don't know where, you know, like if somebody needed to report things.
Well, to do a bridge inspection, you know, you look at it, you give it a score of 1 to 10 on 5 different areas, you know. So just keep, you know, we can do small apps, you know.
Right, I mean, internally, you don't always need the mobile app, the mobile Android coded or iPhone, you know, coded. You could make the application in Windows, have Citrix just, you hit the button that looks like an app, hit the button, it loads, and then you just keep it simple. Picture one, picture two, picture three, loads right into it.
But you're assuming that you have connectivity all the time.
Correct. That's where you need the wireless.
Yep. Yeah. When you're using a device that's got 3G or 4G on it, it's a lot simpler.
Right, but
then if you're dependent on the wireless network.
We have, I mean, you go to other places in New York State and you have no service.
Yeah, there are some places up north that have nothing.
We ran into it in New York City.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We had people that wanted to set up video conferencing just between like iPads or something.
They wanted to use 3G network. 4G wasn't out there yet, or LTE wasn't out there. They wanted to use 3G and do video conferencing. Well, you know, and that was one of my projects. And one-to-one, it worked fine. Well, they wanted four people. Right when you put that third person on, forget about it.
Right.
You know, because, I mean, I think 3G is 750 kilobits, you know, where now LTE, it might be something we can revisit, you know, now. I think LTE is up to, like, 12 megs, and not 4G, so I think you can get it three. But then again, you're always dependent on the area.
So let me shift gears just a little bit and ask you. How are you quantifying the benefit? Is it number of users that can now access the data? Is it lower cost for the hardware or software? I mean, what are the metrics that you're tracking or that your executive team is asking you to report on?
They're not, actually.
That's bad.
It's more of a so-and-so wants it, what can we do for them? Unfortunately, mm-hmm. This is something that won't get rolled out to the masses. You know, we're a small agency.
So, but if we think about the state, mm-hmm. right, great that you've got that going for you. How can we, without metrics, it's going to be hard for you to be a model that other agencies can follow.
The one metric we do use is we have a policy, which now that the whole administration has changed, I'm not sure how that's going to be enforced, if it still will be. You can't have every device you want. So if you're a mobile person on the go, you don't get a desktop. Mm-hmm. You know, you get a desktop or a laptop. If you're gonna have a laptop with a wireless card and a smartphone, well, then you're gonna have more along something like this. So you're saving cost as far as you're not having multiple devices mm-hmm. with multiple plans. That's about as far as it goes, as far as for cost saving type thing.
But you're not quantifying.
Yeah, no, we're actually working on a project to governance this whole thing too. Who's entitled to what? It's kind of the cart before the horse,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
a lot of times in IT, that's the way it gets done.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, we're constantly thinking about that, but.
It's back to my question, because I keep thinking, what's the roadmap that the agencies that don't get that level of funding, or that are coming off a 30-year-old mainframe piece,
where they're going to use?
What is the step-by-step that they're going to be able to follow?
Yeah.
And I think that gets in a little bit of what we're saying, you know, how do we standardize the way the state presents its content?
Mm-hmm.
So that it does show up on the BlackBerry,
yeah.
which is the, you know, this agency's device.
Yeah, I think as mobile is becoming more popular, I think that there's sort of a dangerous precedent that's being set when we refer to the word app, because we're creating an iPhone app and we're creating an Android app, but we don't know what's going to happen 5 years from now. 5 years from now, BlackBerry might come out with the best phone in the world, and now everybody wants to create an app for that. So we're creating all of these apps for these specific devices, and we're sort of foregoing the real big picture here, which is don't create content for devices, create the content for the people. So create the content so that it's going to be so that you're creating useful content for the people that are going to be using whatever it is, if it's an app that you're writing or if it's content that you're trying to deliver, and then the devices will follow. So if you're creating, there's a big push right now for web apps, because if your content is available for web and it's formatted for these web browsers that are out on iPhones and Androids, which are all using WebKit, and then you have BlackBerry devices as well, you're creating content that's usable. Granted, it's not an app, and there's sort of a synonymous app in quotes to mean that it's installable on your phone and you have to get it through your specific store. We had a problem with our sex offender locator app that we created for Facebook, where people thought that this sex offender locator app can be installed on my phone, and then when it wasn't working on people's mobile devices because it's a Facebook app, they were going crazy. And we said, well, why didn't we at first just link them to our website, because our website is formatted for mobile devices and you can see the sex offender registry and look it up right on your phone from right to our website. We didn't need to deploy an app for that. That is compatible with all of the major phones that are out there. And to leave you with sort of a statistic here, Apple might be the most prominent phone that's out in the United States, but worldwide, Nokia is destroying Apple, it's destroying Android, it's destroying everybody. Nokia is the most used phone across the world. That might be your little, the old touch phones from, the 90s, which might not be fully mobile compatible, but you can still get internet on those phones. So is your content going to at least show up on there? Because you're not writing an app for a Nokia, chunky, candy bar phone. You're writing it for these advanced phones out there. So I think that we need to be focusing on content versus focusing on apps as a specificity.
Yeah, and I think that's kind of like where I feel like Citrix kind of fits in, because you don't care what kind of device you deliver it to, as long as you can get the receiver. I think the example I once heard is it's kind of like a DirecTV. It doesn't care what kind of television you hook it up to, whether it's the old CRT screens or the big 52-inch plasmas. You have the receiver, you still get the same content.
Yep. And when we're talking about mobile, I mean, even in this discussion, we're not talking only about apps. I mean, the general tendency is to think that way, because that's what it is. But you guys aren't apps. You're talking about a mobilizing your workforce.
They haven't started writing any apps.
It's all, which is a big component. So that's kind of what I'm, and I've been hearing too, here is get that into the mindset when you're justifying, when you're looking within your organization. Well, maybe the value in your particular organization isn't in developing an app per se, but you get great value out of mobilizing your workforce in various ways. So maybe your focus shifts from, and that's kind of what I've been hearing a lot of people saying, is matching the uses, the users, and the devices or the delivery, I guess. And you've got to keep those three things in mind. And just to get back to your question about cost, I think Cindy mentioned something that was pretty good that we haven't picked up on yet. And it fits within the context of this whole conference, is that the idea of open data. And maybe one of the things we should be thinking about as government agencies especially is just making our data, how do we make our data available so that other people, other organizations, however, can use that data, and maybe they're the ones who create the apps, which could possibly solve some of your funding problems.
Cost is a multifaceted kind of thing. I mean, you have the cost of the device, but you also have their own network administrators, their own support staff. So there's also an issue of their own support staff understanding the device, being able to support these devices and whatnot. So that's another component to it as well. And I guess it depends on the kind of app that this is being targeted for. Like, there are some things where people have to go to client sites and whatnot, and I think that would be a better thing as far as sellability. You know, it could reduce, like, dual entry. Right. That's a big thing, because I've worked on various other applications where people are literally transcribing things on paper, then bringing it back to the office, and then they're like, oh, God, the thing I hate the most is being able to, you know, have to enter this data in, so because the state's requiring it and all this stuff, because they have it on their side, but they don't want to have to re-enter this on the state side. So if they can do it as they're out in the field, you know, that could save dual entry. But there could be apps also where mobile might not be the best solution. I mean, if they're sitting at their desk all day long and it's just a data entry app and that's all they do, mobile might not be the best solution in that situation. So,
or if you mobilize them, maybe they wouldn't have to come in and sit at a desk.
Well, that's a whole issue from
I know, that's,
working
I mean,
from home and other
things that
I don't know, that's a policy.
I think that's an aspect.
Yeah.
And then that gets into something we haven't talked about that's big within government. That gets into labor management, union issues. I don't know if you've encountered those with what you've done in terms of changing people's work behaviors. I don't know if you
No, we're just starting to get into testing.
But that comes up with some people.
Yeah,
we
job classification challenges are huge across the country in states that have unions.
We've done over five different projects over 5 years with the Office of Children and Family Services, looking at deploying mobile devices and the impact that it does have on workers and on how you get the data in and all these different issues. That's available up on our website. But the whole idea of this double entry, and you're one agency where a county has multiple agencies that they have to respond to, and they may have multiple devices on their desktop, which they have to put the same information in for different agencies. That's even beyond this mobile issue.
I just think that would be a really good selling point with certain applications, is the dual entry. I mean, as far as a sellability point.
Yeah, and the roadmap thing.
Yeah.
The other thing I just want to mention about the roadmap, but what we've been finding out from talking to, is that, and I'm not suggesting you were saying this, but just as clarification, that there isn't, I don't think there's a template that fits. There's not one template that fits all. You've got to have that user uses devices thing, and then there might be multiple templates that say, okay, if you're going this way, you know, this is something to think about. If you're this type of, and I don't know, I'll just throw this out. Do you think, are there certain agencies that just the character and culture and mission of the agency would lend them towards, it sounds like you guys were ideal for developing this internal mobile mobility because of the type of workforce you have. It sounds like what you were talking about is the same, where you have people out doing bridge inspections.
Child services, child protective services, because they're all over town, you know.
Yeah.
That anybody that needs to do any kind of like counseling in the field or anything like that.
I mean, that might be one of the more roadmap questions to say, if you're this type of agency, well then look for your greatest benefit in mobilizing your workforce. Transportation is kind of interesting, probably in a lot of ways, but that other agency, you seem to have both. If you have a lot of citizen, you know, and DCGS would be the same. There's a lot of people who want to come out and get that information on child abuse offenders, but there's probably a lot of within the law enforcement services. There's a lot of mobilized workforce. Internal, and probably data sharing. That's another thing we haven't really talked about, just mobile data sharing within agencies, agency to agency. I don't know.
So as we're wrapping up, sort of, who's doing this well? Like, who's on the radar screen federally, internationally, that is, you know, whose apps do you see that kind of make you go, wow, that's really unique? Because I don't think we're, we've got some examples of it, but we're not.
I don't know that many of state or government that.
It's at the local level, really. It's at the municipal level that you're seeing most of it.
San Francisco.
You'll start seeing it out of education a lot, out of the universities, because they're being forced to deal with it. Just because the student population that comes in, they've been, for years it's been, get your kid a laptop before they come to school. Well, now it's get your kid a laptop, a touchpad, a mobile phone, or whatever. So they're in a position where they're forced to deal with this. And I think that'll probably be the leading edge of what we see.
In this project that we've been doing, we do have some examples of, I don't know if they're best of the breed, but they are just examples, such as Congress has one that you can see what's happening on through your Android on the floor as far as where things are and try and impact.
Does it have a fast forward?
Yeah, would anybody rather poke their eyes out and watch that?
Dade County,
New York City. Who else?
Actually, safety and security, too. Homeland Security, police, fire are making use of a lot of mobile applications to talk about where their units are deployed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, real-time mapping and stuff like that is big.
Right.
And matching crime time zones, time when crime occurs in what areas, and matching workforces to go there and alerting citizens to maybe not know that. One other thing I'd like to do before we run out of time. We've heard a lot from people who are actually in the mix already. I don't want to leave out the people who are just coming into the mix. Are there things that you haven't heard here that you need to hear, or has this been beneficial in any way, or is there something that you're really wondering about? I don't want to leave you totally dissatisfied.
Originally.
Amazing we don't. That's a success. Anything else? I kind of killed the whole discussion there. Sorry, it's going so good. Should I knock over something?
What about technologies that scale better for mobile apps as far as resolution and things of that sort? I know there's what we're developing is a Silverlight app, and one of the values of Silverlight that they advertise is its ability to scale to different resolutions, different orientations of the screen and whatnot. I don't know how other technologies compare. Is that?
I don't know.
Do we know?
Is anyone? I really don't.
Because if you're writing an application, let's say in ASP.NET, and it's a solid web app, it looks good on a 1024 by 768, then you decide 2 years from then that you want to make it a mobile app. What does it require? A whole new redevelopment effort, or is it scalable to?
It all depends on your knowledge of the code that's behind it. You know, you can use CSS to make anything look like anything. But do you have 500 pixel wide images that need to be resized and things like that? I mean, with web technologies, you can pretty much do whatever the device that you're accessing it from is capable of. So you can use whatever JavaScript is of supported by whatever device it is, and you can use CSS that's supported by whatever device, and whatever HTML code, etc., that's supported by each browser. So when we moved our site from a plain desktop site to mobile formatted, we didn't change the underlying code behind the site.
Right.
We just changed how it was styled.
Right. But you're saying that's possible. It just takes more work with certain technology as opposed to others.
Yes. Yeah, it is definitely possible to varying degrees of success,
right.
I would say.
Yep.
And I'd say an important caution there is, at least what I'm hearing you're talking about, you're going into a different user experience. I think it gets back to what has been said before. Is that if, doing it on a mobile device, first of all, even if it looked, you're not sitting at a desk anymore. You're moving. You're probably moving. You're doing something. You're looking for different, it has different features, so I think a redesign is, even though you might scale, you might be able to scale your website down, but would anybody actually use it? I mean, I think you have to think about it.
Anything with a GIS we need to be concerned about? Because that's a big component. A lot of what we do with mobiles is people want to map stuff, mash it up. I don't know how that arena is kind of faring out going forward universally.
How much power do you have behind to run a GIS application? I mean, do you have to have I don't know, does it have to be a big beefy CPU memory-wise running GIS?
I can tell you.
Yeah, it's a power hog.
Yeah, with mobile, I don't know. Like you said, we're, whether you're developing for Google or using their APIs or, once again, I think you're getting into specific product stuff of how do we deliver GIS information to the public, and everybody has their favorite type development platforms that, that's another, I think, challenge going ahead might,
And from a strategic standpoint, you could say, well, and this gets to the cost, I can make my website mobile. No cost, I'll do it, fix a style sheet and we're done. There, and now we're mobile.
Yep.
But if nobody's using it or has no benefit, well, then it might be worth
the effort in this case, once you analyze everything, say, well, we need this level of a three-week design development process to create something that's going to cost a little time and money, but it's going to be different, and people are going to use it, and it's going to be effective, so then the justification comes in. So, I mean, those are the kinds of questions I think we're trying to address. So.
Yeah, just quickly, the reason we decided to do that was because our usage for mobile devices on our site was three times that of users in IE6. So we said, rather than fixing IE6 stuff constantly, which we still do, we still support IE6, but we wanted to also make those users on mobile devices have a better experience. So now our users of mobile devices far exceed our users of IE7 as well. So we're drastically gaining mobile users on our site.
I can just tell you with the project that I'm on right now that we haven't seriously looked into making it mobile, but there was talk about what if 2 years down the line management asks for something to be mobile? Now all of a sudden, what are we going to do? So one of the reasons that we chose the technology we did was that it would be easier to make it mobile. I don't know if it would be no effort, but it would be easier. So I don't know if that's why I asked the question whether the choice of technology is a consideration. Just thinking down the road saying, you know, most likely we're going to get a request to make this mobile, but it might be 3 years down the line.
Right, yeah, it's definitely going to happen, yeah. One of those things.
And I just recommend everyone, this is stepping away from your smartphone. There's guys who will show you how to step into it. You guys are going on at 3 o'clock?
3 o'clock next door.
Anytime, anywhere? What's it called?
Yeah, anytime.
I don't know if you have signed up for it. I've seen their presentation. It's interesting stuff, so I'm repping.
We're competing in presentations.
You have the big one?
Yeah.
Thanks, Jim.
All right. Thank you, everybody. That's helpful.